Everyone, it's Alex, and I'm just some guy on the internet. For today, I wanted to talk about the books that I happen to recommend the most to people, and these books aren't even really my favorite books, but I think they're definitely books that can have any reader have a response to them. And with my first pick, it's Uncanny Valley by Anna Wiener, and I actually find that out of all the recommendations I give to people in my real life, most of the time it's nonfiction or memoir. Wiener talks about how she had a job in New York City working in publishing, but trades it for going out west to start a job in the tech industry. And this is a new release too, so the context of it all with sort of this large unknowability of how we understand things like apps and like startup culture, I think is all trying to be compressed in a comprehensive, accessible and funny and clever way of how it's written. And I think in Wiener's case, it's a matter of her feeling this growing imposter syndrome with jobs that she's had in the tech industry because no one really knew what they were doing anyway in the early 2010s when all of this was happening. Wiener is very humble in giving herself credit to the people that she happened to be around at the right place at the right time, talking about things like uncomfortable management and coworkers and just the lifestyle of being in a business like this, especially as a woman, where the second half of the memoir really talks about the internal sexism and the mechanism behind this very male-dominated industry. But again, the driving force is really how much Wiener feels like she didn't ever really know what she was doing. There's even a part where her job becomes solely telework, and in the chat she says goodbye to everyone, and someone responds saying that they didn't even know that she worked with them. I think this memoir does a really great job at understanding that transition phase of how normal it is now for us to interact with things like apps and how we have services where we have ride-sharing apps and companies, and also where people can deliver your groceries to your front door. Just this whole idea of all of us being very acceptable of these growing things involving our technological world. I would describe the overall tone of the memoir being more informative, but still highly personal, teaching me a lot about why or how maybe complicit I've been in just accepting, sort of adapting to this quality of life that it seems like all we do is adapt all the time to new situations and new advancements with how we interact with people. So keeping the same theme of how I think I've noticed with my picks that I predominantly recommend people books that are related to like work or the ideas of work. So the next book I wanted to talk about was Convenience Store Woman by Sayaka Murata. I've already done a review of this on my channel, but just to recap, this is a story about a woman named Kiko that works in a convenience store, and she really loves her job and she loves looking for any openings of improving on herself and improving on her work. And this book isn't like a hidden gem or anything either. I think it's like really popular and a lot of people like it, although I often see it described as this very quirky story, but I actually think it's like a really depressing book about what the idea of work does to us and our mental well-being. At least me sort of adapting it to thinking of like work or professionalism here in the States or in the West. But what's most alarming to me is this idea of Kiko giving some very scary thoughts out into the void, where she at one point says that she thinks of her body as this thing that's slowly dying. And it isn't until she feels challenged by future coworkers that she understands just how pitying it must be to feel so involved in very human things like relationships. And I know I'm not really selling it by how I'm talking about it, but the book is pretty short and I think it does like give a punch of this sort of cheekiness that I think people will really like, especially for anyone that's ever had a job. I think it can really teach someone a lot about re-examining the sort of work-life balance. And beyond that, I think it also helps people or readers examine what the meaning of meaningful work means. For the next book I have here, it's The Friend by Sigrid Nunez. In short, this is really just a book about a woman that takes on the ownership of her friend's dog since he passed away. And I think the reason I recommend this book the most is because when I think of like literary fiction, I think this is like the book. It's like literary fiction with like the trademark symbol at the end. I think it really just packs all the right ways of creating a story that is both contemplative but also really sincere. Sometimes it can veer too much possibly into the metaphorical with what it's trying to talk about in the book, with some philosophical tones about life and relationships, but I think all of that still remains stable just because the voice of our narrator is so strong and very accessible and very engaging. And I've said this before whenever I reviewed this book on my channel, I think whenever I first read it over the summer last year, the essence of the book is understanding the difference between being in love with someone and just loving someone. And I think that's definitely a journey that our narrator goes through. Another nonfiction recommendation that I often tell people to read is An American Childhood by Annie Dillard. I don't know about elsewhere, but I feel like with Annie Dillard that she's a very taught essayist in schools, or at least in college. I know that I read an essay by her in this collection where it was about her being chased by this adult man while she was a child because she threw a snowball at him. And by the time that this man, who's like wheezing, once he catches up to her and her friend, she notices as a child that adults have this sense of feeling this sort of very strong attachment to morality, but also telling people what they think is right, but also at the same time, all of it feeling kind of sad. And I know it's very like me to like always talk about on this channel, really essentially books that are sad and just have people thinking a lot about sadness. But how Annie Dillard just writes about her childhood now as an adult and looking back on it, it's just full of such rich description that is really wonderful. And the way she writes about it always feels like it's an epiphany of rediscovering that feeling every time, which to me is just a feeling that I hope other readers can have when they read this collection. Just that idea of your life being larger than it is, and how you can read the right words beside each other, and it's how you wish you could have described life all along had you known ways to talk about it. And so I have three books left, and they're actually all short story collections, so I'm gonna be pretty rapid fire with them. I love recommending short story collections because I think they're just digestible enough to sort of get a feeling for the writer's tone, but also the sort of quality of how prose is shaped through a short story and how different that is than a novel. I think novels are deliberate in always trying to make you feel different things at different times as you're reading it. And for me, short stories have always been a way of trying to understand what qualities I look for in a story that I can later use as sort of ingredients of being kind of like a checklist of what I can look out for whenever I read novels and trying to see what parts stand out to me that I really love. So the first collection I have here is Nine Stories by J.D. Salinger. I don't care what anyone says. I think I classify J.D. Salinger as like a short story writer. I think it's his best form. I just think there's something he does about his characters and his stories feeling so merciful towards life and towards other people. There's like this sad generosity of all of his characters mostly being sad, but how much they confide in and feel comfort with memory. And with Salinger's stories being so influenced by his experience in the war, I feel like he's writing the stories that he feels like he's always missed out on in real life. So in some ways, there's this magical quality of it all feeling really nostalgic for experiences I've obviously never experienced in such detail or the exact same way, but always feels familiar. And speaking of familiarity, I kind of get that same sense anytime I read Alice Munro, specifically when I first read any work by her being her collection, Dear Life. If I could describe Alice Munro's stories maybe in a different way than Salinger, is that I always feel a bit more disarmed with my own feelings. Where Salinger writes from a place of circumstance for his characters, I think Alice Munro kind of does the opposite. Her characters feel equipped to do anything, but then they always are in this process of reconsideration. There's just this very generous sense of humanity that seeps through all of Alice Munro's stories that feels surprisingly confrontational, but always somehow enlightening by the end, mainly because I think characters, when the story's over, they realize they have so much to contemplate after about what they just experienced. And to top it all off with my short story recommendations for this video, I have The Interpreter of Maladies by Jhumpa Lahiri. I think this collection is pretty incredible. It manages to convey this perfect balance of plot and characterization. The characters she writes are often underwhelmed by life and always feel on the fringes of either giving up completely or always looking for those silver linings. And in the periphery, she often has these other characters become a witness to some form of a character's suffering, Which I promise isn't like a pattern that I seek out in what I read. But I think it's just great, because when I read this collection, all the stories were kind of what I expected them to be, but they always somehow felt very fresh and new and interesting. Lahiri doesn't necessarily reinvent the wheel with how you read about characters going through something, but then by the end of it, something like, you know, reaches a definitive conclusion. With all of these characters in this collection, I just always felt like I wanted to know how they were doing after, or I just felt like I only read a fraction of their life that felt so full. In particular, I remember this definitively, but my favorite stories in here were A Temporary Matter, Interpreter of Maladies, and Sexy. I just think Lahiri's so talented at crafting the human experience in such a short and concise way that I hope that whenever other people read this collection, when I recommend it to them, feel what I feel, which is this result of being more empathetic towards people in my real life, especially for some reason, even just strangers. So those are my most recommended books that I tell people about, at least for now. I'd be really curious to know what books you often recommend most to people and kind of what your criteria is, because I know how I mentioned earlier that the books I recommend aren't often even my favorite books, so I'd wonder if it's the same for you. As always, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.